Welcome and thank you. It's, you know, it's like going to church and speaking to the choir, right? You guys are all the experts and wanting to get to know. It's not like talking to a novice group. But one of the things that I think Kathy just touched upon that I think would be important is that we talked yesterday about going home and implementing your programs. I think the idea for next year also would be not for any one person to be talking a lot. Everybody should come and if they have it again, if they do a two-day course, is to have everybody come and teach how they actually teach, not just I have a curriculum, not that I have two machines or I have one machine or I have a small room or a big room, but that how do you actually teach your residents or your allied health personnel or your medical students? Because I will tell you now that my way is just my way. It's not better for worse. It's just the way I've learned over 7 years of simulation teaching with the VIST and 22 years now as a faculty educator after my fellowship. So, but one of the questions that I always hear every time I go into meetings and I try and put forth the gospel of simulation and Mentice training is that I bought a VIST, now what? Right? And now, and Carlo knows this, is that in the old days people were buying lasers like hot candy in the 1980s and all they would do is sit in that corner at the end and gather dust and it would be a bookshelf, right? And so the idea is that we don't want to do that with a VIST. If you buy it, you have to use it. So I thought this was an apropos. So we're going to try and build some blocks and give you some practical aspects, not too much theory, but more about this is how I do it on a daily basis. And I've done this with multiple institutions, multiple learner groups, from medical students up to faculty to industry, in trying to teach them how to use the machine to learn. All right, so welcome, first of all. I want to give a shout out to everybody who's here, and if your name is not on there, my apologies. I want to give a particularly shout out to Tina. Where is she? There she is. And Bernardo and Jonathan and Facile, because this is really what this is for, right? This is for you guys as the actual, Tina's a PGY3 vascular resident, Bernardo's a PGY2 vascular resident. Jonathan, what year? A PGY5 cardiology fellow?
So second year.
Second year, yep. And Fazil, you're a neurology, right?
Yes, neurology, interventional
neurology. Interventional neurology, excellent, excellent. So these are the people that really matter. And the nice thing is that when you get done, you'll be able to build some curriculum at home and be on your way to an academic career and a great relationship with Mentice, right? Because Mentice, I don't think, is going away unless there's news that we know, Kathy, unless...
Clearly not.
I'm just saying. Everybody thought CAE and all that was okay, but and then, you know, some of the other companies that they've come and gone. But Mentice is here to stay. So this is a lifelong relationship. And you guys are now the top 1% in America for simulation training for residents and fellows. Because there is no one else. So you don't drop down. So you started at the top, will continue. All right? So the workshop today, breakfast, introduction, I've changed the schedule just a little only because I looked at the audience, is that we'll define the target audience, what your needs are, review the goals and objectives, go over just a little bit of educational theory. It's not going to take 30 minutes to do that, trust me. Then we're going to talk about how to integrate the program into a clinical work week. How do you overcome the roadblocks that everybody has? And I hear it at every single meeting. I don't have enough time. Well, I will tell you now, that's a bunch of crap. Excuse the language. It's you have time. Trust me. Understanding your options and performance assessment. What tools do I use? How do I use them? Then we'll do hands-on training. And this timeline will probably shift it up because I don't think it'll, when I was going over it last night, it didn't take as long. And then obviously lunch is a working lunch and we'll start midway through it and we'll talk about how and when to intervene. And we'll have another hands-on training where we'll actually bring you up or you'll be in the small groups and you'll actually do cases and you can use the assessment metrics that I've left in your binder, okay? And then there's a break and then there's the workshop summary, okay? So who's the audience, right? Again, I'm teaching to the choir, but the educators, the people who are interested, are ones who do not use simulation at the present time. And this actual talk, if we do it next year and it'll be broken down a little differently and better, will be for a larger group audience, more diverse. You guys, we're all sort of in the same boat. But it's also designed for those educators who currently use simulation training, but maybe don't use it the way I use it, or maybe use it the way the other person uses it. And they want to know how to use it better, and how to integrate it better, how to talk to your faculty members to say, listen, I only need an hour a month from you. There's an hour in your schedule to go to the lab and teach your our fellows, our residents, on the simulator. And for those who don't use the simulation, the simulator at the moment, how do I become a better educator by using it? And hopefully a little bit of what I've done in the last 7 years will help you. So there's always the questions. You have to have the questions, because if you don't, you'll never get any answers, right? How do I start? Where do I begin? What are my overall needs and training, and curricular and training needs? Nancy went over that reasonably well yesterday. What are my trainees' learning needs? How do they learn? Are they readers, or are they just show uppers? You know, as I almost like youpers, right? They just show up. What are my training needs? Well, how do my trainers teach? Are they imperious? Do they get on the same level as a trainee? Do they dictate, or is it democratic? Are they indifferent? Are they passive? They can't be bothered. You can't find them when it's their time to be in the lab. Oh, I have a case, so I'm on call. Oh, I forgot to tell you that I had another case to do, which is not okay. Do I make training mandatory or voluntary? Do I set performance milestones? Are performance assessment metrics necessary for trainee evaluation? How do I get buy-in from my trainees, I think is what Audra talked about yesterday. We'll go into that. How do I get more faculty involved? We'll get into that. How do I get my institution to support my program? And what are my plans when I go home? I think what I'd like to do is that toward the end, or if we have some extra time, is ask you in a very open forum, have you stand up and tell me what the problem is when you go home. And I'll see if I can just give you an off-the-cuff answer for that. So, what are the goals and objectives? Well, we want you to understand some real basic principles of adult educational theory that might help you begin to write curriculum or talk to your people or the non-believers, right, or the disbelievers. We want to identify options for curriculum design and content. I want you to understand what are the options for integrating your training on a work week. There are 5 basic approaches. One isn't there, I think some are better than the others, but you have to decide based on your training program. Then you have to be able to go home, be able to identify the types of performance assessment instruments and understand their advantages and disadvantages. You really need to understand the role of skill task analysis and how it fits into training people on the VIST, how you acquire skill with error analysis and error correction, how you identify and compare different teaching intervention strategies. Am I an interrupter, or am I a passive evaluator, only evaluating things globally, as opposed to interrupting and doing contextual interference, as they call it? Do I utilize hands-on simulation demonstrations? We're going to do that, and then we're going to develop, hopefully, a practical approach, maybe on the whiteboard, to integrate some of the simulation and skills training information and curricula that you learned here today. Okay, let's just talk a little bit about educational theory. Okay, adult learning and performance expertise. Adults want to self-direct their learning. They want to respond to reinforcement. They're competency-based learners. We don't want to learn anything that doesn't apply to tomorrow. And in today's world, we don't want to learn anything that doesn't apply to making money. I had this talk, we talked with Ron and everyone else. I got a case, I'm going to make $3,000. I don't know, I'm not doing simulation for free. Are you kidding? Are you out of your mind? You do it. You like it so much. They want to apply knowledge pragmatically to current circumstances. And adults learn best when they're involved, which gets to the fact, because how do I get my residents, how do I get my faculty involved? They want to be involved in determining what, how, and when they learn. They are not passive learners. And you have to teach them what they want. If you try and teach a resident something completely off, they will shut you off, turn you off immediately. If you try and get a faculty member to teach something they have no interest in, they are just going to say thank you very much and walk away. So, adult learning involves instructing for results, and John, you have to develop an 8-week curriculum that we'll try and help you with. You have to think about what do you want your fellow residents to get out in 8 weeks reasonably, okay? What's the result of that? At 8 weeks, what do I want them to get out of, right? The 5 principles of adult learning: leadership, experience, appeal, respect, and novel styles. Leadership: adult learners want to lead their own training. Experience: they want to be able to use their own judgment and decision-making capabilities, and they learn better if they know that they can apply it tomorrow. So if I'm teaching somebody to do an iliac angioplasty and I know that they have one coming up in a week or so, they're much more interested as opposed to doing an IVC filter where they may not see one for 4 months. So they want that connection. You have to get them, you have to appeal to their inner sense of what motivates me, like that. You know, what's my motivation as an actor, right? They want to know, does it benefit me? There has to be a need-to-know sort of attitude with them. And you have to respect the learners and their personal experiences, because everybody comes from a different area. And if you try and cookbook training, you're going to fail, because there are people who come from many different places. We have a lot of people who come from other countries who have not even a close experience to what we have, and we can't fit everybody into the same place. And you have to be able to provide different learning environments, novel styles. Like one of the things I do when I teach general surgery residents is that we have a fall surgical Olympics. I'm into de-identifying things. I think that you have to identify your competition and your results, because take a look, the person next to you, he's taking away your breakfast tomorrow because he's going to be doing the case in New York, femtib or a fempop or a vein. So my whole thing is that we present different ways to get them excited about learning in a multisensory fashion. Pike in 1947 developed these laws of adult learning, so this is nothing new. Number one, adults are babies with big bodies. Learning is enhanced by hands-on experience. Law number two, people don't argue with their own data. You know, if somebody believes something's right, you can't argue them out of there. Learners' ideas and concepts facilitate learning. So use what they know when you're trying to teach them to build on that. And they want to have fun when they learn, you know. I'm also all about being very stressing the learner, putting them on the spot. What I teach on the VIST is I teach it like an oral board exam. It's just not about whether or not you can get a wire in the other iliac artery. As you're going over the iliac to get into the common femoral artery in the SFA, I'm asking you what the percentage of people are going to have success if you balloon dilate this task B lesion. And what are you going to do if it embolizes? Are you prepared already? So the making them think on their feet, which I think gives them, it's fun, all right? But I can also be a bit imperious too, and if somebody is not engaged, I can step right onto my oral board examiner box and just blister them. And so I have some variety and variability in terms of how I actually teach. And then law four is that if learning won't take place unless behavior changes. It's not what you know, but what you do is that counts. So you have to apply it, okay? Adult versus children learners, we all know this. So children rely on others to decide what's important. Adults decide what's important. They accept the information at face value. Adults do not. They base it on their belief system. They expect that what they're learning is going to be good for their long-term future. Adults want to know what it is now. Children have blank slates, and we all know this if you're a parent. Adults have substantial experience, which to draw may have fixed viewpoints. And children have little ability to use their previous knowledge resource to help them, while the adults have that ability. Okay. The other thing is that Irving Lord in 1947, 4 ideas. If you want to teach an adult learner, it has to gain something, has to be something, have to do something, you have to save something. Very interesting. And there's lots of great things to read about as you develop curriculum, because it's just not about taking what I've offered in the binder and going home and changing it to cardiology or to allied health personnel or to general surgery. There's a little bit more to it than that. You have to think about what you're trying to do. Because adults are multisensory learners, right? Visual learners, auditory, kinesthetic, and this combination of interactive activities will increase the learning and retention in most adults. And again, it's theory, and we're done. But it's important. So as you develop curriculum, because trust me, what's in the binder was not in the binder 7 years ago. I actually had to, you know, a lot of pluses and minuses, a lot of successes and failures to get to this point. And a lot of people, it didn't work. A lot of people just went right over their head. A lot of the times I was impatient and it didn't work. So let's talk about curriculum design, content, and structure. Are we okay so far with that? Okay. Not meant to bore you, but it's just meant to, when you're actually beginning to design a curriculum, think about what you want. I work with Tina at the University of Michigan, and she had, her job is to design a curriculum for the 0 and 5 program with Dr. Rechtenwald. And she has to think about the other 6 people or 7 people and then the general surgery residents that are in her group, and she has to think, how am I going to develop their education on a simulator? Okay, so she has to think about some things. All right, so I love this slide, and I love Sean Bean, right? You know, so starting a curriculum, where do I begin? One does not simply pull a story out of one's arse, you know. It's that you have to have an idea about where to go. And this comes from Kern, and Dr. Schindler mentioned yesterday, it's a 6-step process for curriculum development. You identify the problem, what the general needs assessment is. You then target the specific needs of your learners. You develop competency-based goals and objectives or milestones, and then you put in the educational strategies to get you there, then you implement it. Then when you're done, you evaluate via feedback from the participants and the other faculty members, how did I do, just like they're going to do for this course. Okay? Is there too much talking, not enough hands-on training? Do I already know all of this? Do I need to know more? Okay. I like to think about curriculum design concepts in a reverse engineering point of view. I look at it this way. If I want to teach a resident how to tie at 6-inch depth, that's the success, right? That's the learning outcome. So then I have to reverse it back and say, well, what is the requirement to get to this point as I come back? What was the program of action? Well, it was making sure that your suture was long enough, and if you're tying one-handed, that you're tying within a restricted airspace, and you're deciding what hand is your dominant hand and what hand is your non-dominant or mobile hand, and whether or not you're putting up too much anterior tension. Are you going to throw a slip knot? Are you going to throw a square knot? Am I going to, how many knots am I actually going to throw? What suture am I going to throw, et cetera, et cetera? So you reverse engineer the outcome, and you get to the problem, in a sense. Well, the problem is he's tying with too short a suture. He's using the wrong hand. He doesn't understand how to get a knot at depth to stay, et cetera, et cetera. So, curriculum design styles, okay? There's the full curriculum, which in my case is 8 sections, the way I've devised it, 8 sections. There's a syllabus only, and then there's a presentation and video demonstration style, where you just have goals and objectives and an assessment. Every type of learning project that you do will require one of the three, but not all three, I don't think. For example, if I'm teaching Bernardo to do a one-hand knot tie at depth, he doesn't need a full 8-section, 25-page curriculum. He'd probably be better off with a 1-page presentation, video demonstration with a simple goals and objectives, an assessment, and a single learning tool. You have to decide what best fits for you. I don't know about your experience, but before I came last week, we were teaching hemostasis skills because I teach general surgery residents. And I asked them, I said, how many of you read the syllabus that I just sent 2 weeks ago, which is 15 pages long, and it's 8 to 10 hemostasis skill techniques? I had the same response that you're now giving me. No hands went up. And I sort of got angry, and I said, I put all this work in, and you guys didn't do anything, right? I wanted to lay some F-bombs and just like, why? This is a waste of my time, guys. You're not ready. And then I realized that the problem was with me. After all these years, right, I'm supposed to be this and that, and I wasn't this or that, because the problem was me. I didn't need to give them a 15-page syllabus handout, right? That's the handout that goes on the shelf that says, hey, guys, look what I did here. I got 30 modules, 15 pages apiece. What I should have given them was a 1-page handout that says, these are the 8 things that we're going to do. This is how you need to do it. And quality, this is a speed. And they probably would have read that, because not everybody reads anymore. Everybody's tired. And my audience were interns, so they're exhausted. Might be different if I gave that to you guys and you were here to learn, because you're not exhausted. You're at a hotel. You're being fed. Everything's doing fine. So again, I didn't respond to my learner audience, and I didn't pick the right curricular style. Well, let's talk about what a full curriculum, and you should be able in your binders to see this, but it's an 8-section piece that I use where it has a syllabus and includes didactic lectures, hands-on tabletop demonstration. This is the full thing. I don't know if it's in there. It may not. I don't think that's in there, right? I think this is just my overview. And then this is how we would set up to do, for example, we do this for aortic aneurysm teaching on a simulator and then in an open glass model where we have the syllabus, we give the lectures, we do a tabletop demonstration, we have expert faculty demonstration, then we do a simulation skills practice on a glass model, then this VIST, and then we do a performance assessment. And then at that time, we do the feedback. This is not in your folder. This is just an overall thing. And then, which is cognitive task analysis, technical skill analysis, and then we do a pre-training and post-training questionnaire. That's the whole program if you were to come to a weekend seminar, okay? So that is a full curriculum. That's pretty intensive, okay? This is just more of a development style. If you guys were going to come to Wayne State and we're going to do aneurysm training, this is what the day would look like for you. All right. This is the full curriculum, whereby this one is an IVC inferior vena cava filter through option the option filter in Argonne Medical, where we'd have the cover page and then we'd have a table of contents, which is the 8 sections. Okay. And it would be broken down into this, and it's like a book chapter. I mean, there's a lot of information in here, and it may or may not be suitable for what you're trying to teach. The syllabus with its 11 parts, there's evaluation forms, an OSATS, which is an observed structured assessment of technical skills, simulation proficiency, or SPAR, and then a CPI, which is a clinical performance assessment estimate, which is just like a global rating scale. And then again, for the builders of curriculum, how much did it cost to put on this on, and what the literature review, and then questions and answers. You want a full curriculum, that's what you do. It's a lot of work. And again, part of the things that I've found in the last 7 years, nobody wants to write a lot of curriculum because it's a lot of work. They'd rather use what people have and share, as Nancy said. So, and it takes a lot of time. How about a syllabus only curriculum? Well, that's divided up into 13 parts, and I think this is much more palatable, much more easy to swallow and build. This is devised by the, this system is used by the APDVS and the APDS, and it is used by us at Wayne State and probably others elsewhere, where you have an overview and a module rationale, objectives, assumptions of your pre-training skill, reading references, anatomical considerations, description of the model, procedural instruction, common errors and prevention strategies, expert demonstration, suggested time length, equipment requirements, practice guidelines, and documentation of proficiency. That is in your module, and you guys should pull that out if you want to look at it. This is what the content looks like, and we can really kind of go over that. You should have that. It should be on, in the back. Keep going. Oops, come back one. Yep. And it should be what you guys are going to do today, which is the ipsilateral iliac angioplasty and stenting. So this is the module that if you were in my lab, this is what we would give you as part of it, right? With the syllabus as a template. And this is how it would work. But this is the actual module, right? That's the module. And you would have supposed to have read beforehand. And we'll go over, and this is just one of, these are the first 3 pages. But the idea is that when you are writing curriculum, and again, this isn't a writing workshop, but you need to know how this goes, is that the overview and the module rationale is the global view of what you're trying to accomplish. Their learning objectives are the cognitive and technical objectives you're trying to meet or to learn, have the resident or the trainees learn. In order to do some modules, a certain level of skill is necessary and clinical knowledge. Doesn't make sense to have somebody who's never put in a wire all of a sudden doing a carotid stent, right? His skill level won't allow him to do that, and it will be only failure. The references and the preparation should be directed toward the module. It doesn't have to be a end-all to be-all. It should be directed referencing. The anatomic considerations, you can't do anything in surgery or medicine without knowing anatomy. As simple as that. And you should have an ability to describe the skill task, and the procedure. What's the workstations like? What's the training instruments and devices? What are the skill tasks, and procedure steps that we're going to work through? What are the assessment instruments you're going to use? And the resident and the trainee is going to need to be reading all this, right? So that when they come to your lab, they are totally prepared for this. And again, obviously the other group did not, but they were supposed to have read the hemostasis module. And then laboratory module instruction, this is the actual steps of the procedure that they're actually going to go through. And this section 7 is very important because this is the actual step list that actually then generates your assessment instruments.
I'm not sure I see it in the blanket.
Yeah, it's...
Is it? I hear a lot of pages and I'm like...
Right after the blue tab. Yeah.
Right after the blue tab?
Right after the blue tab.
And it's this one.
Oh.
Show her the cover of it.
So yeah. This is what
I just want to make sure you guys have it.
Yeah, that's the 15-page thing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I didn't think you guys wanted me to go through page by page on a 15 thing. So, but this is the over. So that would be the syllabus. So in this one, when the one that we did here, this one's 14 pages, right? That obviously shouldn't be read the day before. But the idea is with the cover page, you have the overview, the learning objectives, and I'll leave it to you to read it when you go home, the assumptions of the clinical knowledge and technical skills, and then the readings. And then we move here, and you can see the procedures that we're going to be planning to do. This is what we're going to do today, okay? And I tried to keep it relevant. You're going to do a non-selective angiogram. You're going to do a non-selective AIF angiogram. You're then going to do a selective ipsilateral iliac angiogram to identify the lesion in the normal anatomy. And then you're going to perform a common iliac artery angioplasty and stenting today. But more importantly, you're going to evaluate. Somebody else is going to do that, and I'm going to show you how we do that up here. I'll pick one of the lucky four winners. And then here's the procedural steps. And I'm just going to go through this as an example, but you can read through. So one of them is the pre-preparation issues that you need to go through, like timeouts and everything else. You have to check the functionality of the table. One of the things, and when we talk about how do I get residents to think that the simulation training is lifelike and real, is that you have to do the same things in simulation that you do in the OR. So if I have a resident or a trainee come into the lab and just sort of nonchalantly, indifferently sort of puts his stuff down, puts his coffee down and steps up and then wants to start, I mean, I'm immediately giving him a huge amount of grief, or her, because the idea is that you didn't come prepared. You should have been checking the table, checking the II, making sure it works, because if you don't, and in that odd circumstance in real life that you put a person on the table, all of a sudden fluoro doesn't work, how much money is that costing the hospital? Or maybe I put a catheter in a groin, all of a sudden fluoro doesn't work because I didn't check. Very rare, but that's a red flag for Medicare. They're going to say that's an inappropriate procedure, and you just wasted an hour because you've had people, and they've been in recovery, not in recovery, but pre-op. They go into the lab, you stick them, it doesn't work, or you don't have the right equipment, or something doesn't happen. You have to take them off the table, pull the catheter out, hold pressure. I mean, how much money does that cost? I mean, that's a disaster clinically. It's a disaster public relations-wise. So, again, we want to take them through each step, and the way I've designed this, and you design it any way you want, this serves as a template for you, is that I put down the steps, and then if there's something of importance between one step or the other, I put it in bold, indent it, change the font size so it sticks out in your head, okay? This is a style. It's not right or wrong. It's just my style. And a lot of, we'll look at you guys will go home and read these steps, and you'll say, I don't do that. And that's okay, but that's your style. You could eliminate a lot of this stuff, but still, this is just one way to write it, and you should think about that. Does that make sense? Okay, all right. Not everybody has to do what I do, and I don't expect that, because that would be very, very boring. But they have to be able to have something to read to understand the conduct of the operation, because in my experience, if they come in and they're not prepared, If they don't know how to go from A to Z, you can't assess their quality with a global rating scale. And that's, we're going to go over that later on, is that procedural checklist, global rating scale. If they don't know the conduct of the operation, you can't use time as a surrogate marker for assessment. All right? So if somebody doesn't know how to go from here to here, they may sidetrack it and get done in 2 minutes. And they're thinking, oh, I'm fast as heck. And I'm thinking, well, you skipped 8 steps. So actually, it should have normally taken you 10 minutes. It took you 8. So we really, even though on the checklist and the assessment, it says 8 minutes and you look good, it's wrong. So until somebody can get a procedural checklist up to the 100% level, again, we'll go over this, you can't use time as a marker. And we take the step back. So what happened is that they didn't know how to do the operation as you're suggesting it, okay? And so again, there's a lot of interplay between checklists, rating scales, problem-based learning systems, and assessment. All right? Here's a presentation and video demonstration example for a skill task. This is what I call Penrose around the clock. It is a way, and you can see that it is simply how to drive a single needle and suture through 12 single dot targets on 12 Penroses, and it's designed to teach force hemp handling and needle driving skills. Audra is the SVS VAM leadership for and director for resident and medical student education, so she's running this program that may include part of this. You can well imagine that if we had to send something to the 100 and 200 residents and students that come, and it's not going to be a 15-page module, that if we were going to do that, we don't, she does not, but we'd send this half-page paragraph for them to read. This is much more palatable in terms of reading for a resident who or a student who has no time. And it's based on what's the assessment goal? Testing needle driving accuracy, forehand technique, loading and unloading the needle, grasping the tissue. This is the description of it. This is the model that we're using. This is the clinical correlation. This is the time that it should take you to do that. Now, I didn't put that in, there's an expert time. And then these are the errors that they need to look at, and this is how they score. So everything in that one half or that one page is there for the learner to use as a way to say, boy, I kind of know what I need to do on this basic forehandling skill, and I didn't have to read through 15 pages of boring syllabus, okay? Now, if I was to say we're going to do an abdominal aortic endograft repair, this obviously one page isn't enough, right? So you fit the syllabus, you fit your assessments to the procedure, skill task, or skill that you're doing, and the needs of the learner. Does that make sense? Okay. I know all of you guys know this. One of the things that I've found in discussions is that you have to find a way to take your internal knowledge and articulate it in a wisdom-based manner externally. And that's where a lot of times is practice. You know, we have an Allen Iverson slide about practice. Okay. Here's another thing that we have. I have a 77 skill task program that, again, basic skills, skill tasks. Well, it doesn't take a 15-page syllabus to do each one. All right. So we use a half or a single-page description of that. It's a performance-based assessment. It's an initial basis for evaluation that provides limited assessment, and it prepares residents and fellows for a higher level fidelity modules, okay? So start small, think big, so to speak, all right? And so I wouldn't use a full curriculum or a full syllabus for that. I'd use a simple goals and objectives, error identification, and skill description. So again, what I've been talking about is how do I choose what style, right? Depends on your audience. What are your goals and objectives? If I'm teaching medical students, the objectives are less. It depends do you expect your audience to read? Do you expect your audience to prepare? I made the mistake with our residents. I won't make it again. Do you expect your proctors to read? That's the other thing that you have to be thinking of, right? You want to develop curriculum? John, who's going to be running the curriculum in Cincinnati that you're going to need to develop? So there's going to be a faculty member, right? So one of the things that you'll go back to him and say, I think I have an idea about what we need, but you're going to have to get him to get buy-in to faculty, which we'll talk about later, about, well, the faculty's going to need to do this. We're going to train about catheters for, you know, left main, or right, you know, coronary cannulation or whatever you're trying to develop, right? And then you have to decide, are your faculty proctors going to prepare? Are they just going to show up because I'm a cardiologist and I know everything? No different than I'm a vascular surgeon, right? Or I'm an interventional radiologist. I don't need to do anything but just show up. That really doesn't work. They have to prepare. And then what's the amount of training time that you have available? And then what's your training module? All this is great, but if we try to do what everything that we're going to do today on some glass model and not on the Mentice VIST, all this would not be very useful, okay? So the model has to fit the curriculum, and the curriculum should fit the model. So these are some of the things that I do at Wayne State, and so we just want to go through this real quickly about how we've tried to develop different ones, all right? We're still on time, Kath?
I would say we are.
Okay, good. So we do an MS2 skills night. We do an advanced surgical skills elective. I do a PGY1 boot camp. We do vascular surgery training seminars. We do the required skills in vascular surgery. We have an endovascular stimulation curriculum, and I have an overall curriculum. Not all of them need the same curricular development, right? The MS2 surgical skills was a program for surgical interest groups in MS2. Well, they're not going to want to read a 15-page. They're still trying to get through pathophys, right? They want a one-page assessment, a description, and they don't want to be assessed. I mean, this is a volunteer thing, right? They just want to find out who's interested in surgery. So we did weekly three-hour sessions. We gave a presentation and a video, basic skills, no assessment, right? Very simple. We have an advanced surgical skills course for medical students who want to go into surgery, preparing them for surgery. And so it's 1 month, 160 hours. We go over all these modules. This one does have a full, because I have their full attention, 40 hours a week for 4 weeks. Full syllabus curricula, pre-testing and post-testing. And it's one of the highly ranked ones because we have, it's faculty taught. It's not fellow or resident taught. It's primary faculty who are teaching this, which the students love because they don't always get that on rotations. We do 12 students a month for 50 for the 4 months. Highly sought after. And we make them work. They cannot come to class. Because if they fail, number one, it's $5,000 out of their pocket. That's what it costs per month at Wayne State for whatever rotation. They break it to $50,000 in a year. And they realize that if they don't pass, they're probably not going to get the residency. And it's only your career, right? That's what we tell them. It's only your career. So do not come unprepared, right? It's a dicey thing being a medical student these days. It's not like when I was there, probably not like when Carlo was there. It's different, right? So that full syllabus. PGY1 skills training, it's a 5-month program. It's our boot camp, 40 residents, 6 specialties. We simply do skills training, whereas the med student did both patient management problems. But this is just skills training. Full syllabus curricula is what they're supposed to do, but they didn't. Pre-course baseline assessment, we do a fall surgical Olympics to keep it fun, because I don't know about you, but interns lose sight of things about September. You know, I believe all interns should get a vacation in September because they're just burned out. They should just go away for 3 days and come back, and then they'll be rested. But and we do pre and full course final assessment. They're supposed to read this, right? This is their skill. This is their OR. Most of them get less than 50 cases per year. So this is their operating room, okay? We do a vascular skills training seminar. I do it once a month. This is what I call the stairway to vascular success, and it starts with least complex and goes up to more complex. These are open skill models. There are 11 of them, and we take 6 different special programs around the Detroit area, which would be Wayne State, St. John, Beaumont, Henry Ford, DMC, Sinai Grace, Providence. And once a month for 3 hours, we teach vascular skills on open, intermediate, low fidelity models. We're moving to high fidelity later on. And that's done with a simple presentation by me, video demonstration. There's no mandatory assessments. We provide food, no alcohol, but it's fun. And the residents get to mingle. That's one of the nice things about being in Detroit, probably the same way in Chicago. You have lots of residency programs where people can get together. There's no pressure. I have no stake in any of their training other than I like to do it, so they don't feel like they have to come to their mentor and have to be there, so there's really no pressure. I bring the assessments if they want to get set, if they want to, you know, challenge the faculty with the faculty. So again, it's fun, like we talked about, but it's not mandatory. The required skills, there are 77 skills for basic skills that I think are required in vascular surgery. And again, presentation, video, pre-testing and baseline testing is available, same thing if we do that. We haven't been able to put all this into play because it's a lot of time and there isn't really meant any other person but me. It's sort of a one-man show, unfortunately. And again, then we have the overall vascular and endovascular curriculum that I developed over the last 7 years, which is basically 68 modules, 5 skill categories, all have full curriculum, which is what you have in your binder. Pre and post module assessments using checklists and rating scales and SPAR and CPI, and now PBSAS. And so this was sort of a labor of love for me because at the time, vascular surgery in 2007 as a society didn't have anything. And I thought this is what they needed. We needed to mimic and do better than and do more than what the general surgeons had done. And the categories are basic skills, clinical skills, non-invasive, open vascular, and endovascular skills. The curriculum is variable in length, but it's still full curriculum that you have in there. All right, does that make sense? So you can, again, the bottom line is, if I was to say it in one sentence, that it's your curriculum development will be variable. You have to understand who you're trying to get to, and then you have to retrofit it back to their needs. And what I have found is that none of this that I'm talking about now, I could not have talked it to you in 2007 because I didn't have the experience. I was just getting started with the relationship with Mentice, which I'm very grateful for because it permitted me to have a model to serve as the basis to do all the development, all right? Okay, and it led me into different pathways. And I'm grateful for that, all right? All right, so now we have a syllabus. Now we have ideas about how we want to do this, about who we want to teach, what kind of syllabus are available, what kind of curriculum. And it's not my job to teach you how to write it today. It's to show you the path to get there, all right? As Kathy said, this is a 2-day course. If we wanted to get in real detailed for next year, we could have a writing workshop as well, part of it. Where we could actually do team-based, or we can do individual and write. Okay, we'll present the problem. For example, we don't have time today, but say the problem is, Ron, what's the problem that you think your residents have? Just one problem.
They come in with a lack of education about endovascular tools.
Okay, so one of the things would be develop a basic catheter guide wire chapter, a syllabus for skills. And we'd work through that model, and we maybe next year we'd develop a curriculum for that, and about rationale, module, all the reading references, all those things, how to set it up that makes sense, right? Ron comes from a different training background than I do, but we all work at the same instruments, so I think it'd be good. So that would be one thing for next year. But we can't do that today because we want to get you on the simulator. We want to get you teaching. So how do you integrate it? Well, there are many different methods of how people train these days, and you have to pick. We still on time?
Perfect.
Okay, good. All right, good. I'm trying to talk fast, well, my voice left. So there's interval training and mass training. There's best performance motivation. How many of you know what interval training is? Raise your hand.
I do, but it doesn't have anything to do with that.
Oh, yeah. So interval training means that you get training at certain intervals around the time. So I get it once a month, once a week. Mass training, which is thought I get it once and that's it, found to be not very good. And so you have to think about how am I going to set my system up for interval training. Best performance motivation, I think you have to have a milestone for people to work in these days. There's too many other distractions. There has to be a milestone. There has to be a consequence for success. There has to be a penalty for failure. I'm sorry, I come from an athletic background, and that's how I was brought up as a kid, and that's how I've sort of lived my life as an adult. If you don't perform, you don't get paid. You know, it's simple as that. This touchy-feely, it doesn't work. And so I tell the residents, I said, you're being profiled economically from now on. Hospital is going to decide you're either economically viable or you're not. And if you're not economically viable, I'm going to give the opportunities to somebody else who is. And so Performance, motivation, milestones are important. Proficiency-based training, mandatory and voluntary. We can take voluntary off now. It has to be mandatory. Nobody will come. Even under the best intentions, there's too many distractions. The people in North Carolina, Stephanidis and others, believe that overtraining, you train beyond the level of mastery so that when you have extinction of your skill set, you're still at a master level, as opposed to getting to an expert level, not doing things and dropping it down, skill extinction, and you're no longer an expert. So they believe that overtraining increases retention of skill sets. High feedback versus low feedback. We did a study on FLS training for residents where we looked at high feedback versus low feedback in an open gym approach, and we found that the high feedback people actually increased their skill set 4 times over a low feedback, which makes sense, right? I mean, again, a lot of this stuff is self-intuitive, but you just have not heard it on a white paper or seen it or heard it from somebody else. Then we have distributed, deliberate, and structured practice, and we'll go over that a little bit later. Distributed practice means you practice at various intervals for set length of time. Structured practice means there are goals and objectives, and there are proficiency-based, performance-based milestones that you have to achieve. And Henrik Ericsson talks about the 80-hour, about the 10,000 hours to get skilled. And I will tell you that repetition means a lot. The 80-hour work week takes away probably 20% of experience in residence, and Erickson's data probably doesn't apply to us because our training at the present time for residents is a closed system in that people have to go home. And part of my, one of the things that I want to do is I'm having some conversations with Carl Blamoria from Northwestern, who's on this committee for simulation and nationally, is to try and develop a program where the actual training in the skills lab is not part of the 8-hour work week. We're going to have to try and figure that out because it's like, why do I want to limit my trainees' education? I don't tell them they can't go home and read. Why should I tell them they can't go to the lab and work on things? It's not service work. It's not work. And they should be able to do that with me in the room, with you in the room. Okay. But deliberate practice is what he recommends, 10,000 hours, right? Swimmers, musicians, runners, golfers, whatever, 10,000 hours. And if you actually look at the number of hours that I think general surgery residents in a 5-year residency program now, it's about 8,000. And so we're training people to a sub-level for psychomotor skills. You have to give it a well-defined task. You give it of appropriate difficulty. If it's too easy, they won't learn. If it's too difficult, they won't learn. You want to be able to provide immediate feedback. These are principles when you're in the lab. You want to be able to give them something that they can do over and over and over again without degradation. And you want to be able to give them the abilities to self-correct or you to externally correct their errors and identify them. And you want to do it in a defined session time. I think that nothing we should do in simulation should last longer than 30 to 45 minutes. Bun, done. I tell our residents, you have 30 minutes to get done. What I teach you on open skills, you can get done in 30 minutes. So when we go back to the bullseyes, I don't think anybody, or the Penroses, they should not be doing that more than 15 to 20 minutes. Are you kidding me? 30 minutes? I mean, it's in and it's out, right? There's a defined session time. What happens is that you get fatigue. You get module and model fatigue. And you stop learning. I have found that residents stop learning after 30 minutes. And after a while, they stop learning after about 3 minutes of listening to me. And so I seriously, it's a joke, but I seriously try and limit what I have to say. I'm in and I'm out. And I let their actions, and then I go to the teaching point of view. Because if all you were doing is listening to me like you guys have to now. But if this is a room of students and we're going to do this, I'd have been done 25, 30 minutes ago, right? It'd have been a 5-minute introduction because my expectation is, and your expectation is that they should be prepared, right? I shouldn't have to talk for 30 minutes to get the module points across. I should talk for 5 minutes and you should work for 25. And then in that 25 minutes, I'll be critiquing you, giving you my expertise as a vascular surgeon of 22 years and as an educator of 22 years, good or bad, right? I'm giving you, because my job is to make you better. And so we want to do that in a defined session time because we all know this. We don't have time. There's no time. Bernardo, how much time do you have during the day to do simulation training? on your own without Audra setting it up, Dr. Duncan setting it up.
Not much.
Right. And so, do you think you have 40 minutes? And think you have an hour free time?
I could.
Right.
Rotation, obviously, but I could.
Yeah, okay. But if I asked Bernardo, if I was part of Audra's group, and I said, well, let's go work 3 hours on the simulator, he's going to go, are you kidding me? I don't have time for that. And at least, you know, I have 30 minutes, Dr. Mattos. I said, good, we can go do an iliac. But it would require him to be prepared, right? Okay. So defined session times will be very good in terms of how you set people up for practice. So this is what I came up with. I think there are 5 educational strategies for implementation. Open gym approach, block time approach, the independent study approach, the simulation skills rotation approach, and then a clinical rotation integration approach. And we're going to go over all those, okay?
Can I ask more?
Yeah.
I mean, the way our sim center is pretty much, it's on lockdown between certain hours, mm-hmm. and it's very busy. So the room that we use for vascular is used for something else
right.
many other times. So, I mean, it's not, there is no, oh, I can go over there whenever. It's we literally sign up for the time there a year in advance.
Wow.
So I just signed up for 2015, you know, for the whole year, because it's extremely busy. There's no way. I guess my question is there something that we can do? When I was a resident, they would tell you, you go home and you tie 7,000 knots
right.
and you sew orange peels together. They would, you know, and I give these guys Castros when they come in. But is there some endo version of that? I don't know. I mean, that's how I did all my
Well, so you have, but you have multidisciplinary folk using the VIST besides you, right?
Yeah, everybody.
Right. So part of my argument, so I think that's a great question, is how do I get more time on a simulator, which is a problem that not many people are asking, I will tell you. Most people have all this time but no interest,
yeah,
right?
It's just not, and it's not even just the VIST. Other people can use it, but it's not that busy. It's that it's in a room where it's that busy.
Right.
Right. Just a lot of time that we don't have.
So I think the struggle that we have coming from our sim center.
Yeah.
While technically it is a task trainer of some sorts, it's not something that can just be walked in and ran like a laparoscopy trainer that has little to no parts. You know, you need to know which wires you're going to use, you need to know which sheets you're going to use. And if not maintained or products put away properly, whoever you're going to come use it next, it's not. It's hard to let it be used as a self-service model. I know that we've done some talks about trying to have some open hours to where they could use it, but it's just you almost need supervision to run it.
I would respectfully disagree in a sense, and I've been using it once for 2007. I think part of the job is to find a resident or a junior faculty educator, right, or somebody in your that, because they should be able to get on the machine independently, which means you have to teach it. I think that you can set it up that you can actually don't need you or Audra there. But what that requires is a little bit of work up front in terms of setting up, maybe working with Chris and other people to get set up, but it actually should be set up. Now, I will tell you that my first experience with the VIST, I did not let a resident touch the machine without me there because I didn't trust them, okay? And they didn't display the interest or the knowledge for me to let them go independently. So I understand exactly what you're doing. Our situation was different. We had it in a room next to my office, and I had the key. And nobody got in. So for you, Audra, to answer your question, I mean, you can actually develop enough expertise with the residents or the faculty that you can go in there at any time and work through it. The other problem is, Audra, I think, is that it's like what Nancy said, is you may have to develop a curriculum, a year's worth of curriculum, and say, we need 2 or 3 hours a month or a week or whatever the interval that you decide is valuable. And it needs to be set in stone ahead of time. And that's the preparation part, is what I'm hearing. Is that, what I'm hearing is that you would like to come in, say, 8 o'clock at night on a night when you're free to work, or 5 o'clock, but that there's no mechanism for you to get through it? Is that, to get into that?
Well, I'm almost thinking that maybe the the Sim Center isn't the no offense, but maybe it shouldn't be there. Maybe it should be in my office. I don't know because I cannot, the way we're structured, because we're so structured, and it's so such a huge Sim Center, it's almost too much that they can't use it freely.
Right.
If they can't, they don't go in. They can't go in at night on a weekend and just do it when they're free.
I concur. There are times where we debate this on other trainers of sort. Is the Sim Center really the best location for it?
Right.
You're talking about like an homage table, some other stuff. It has a great wow factor and good for tours and stuff, but is that really the best location for it? Again, stepping back, I could walk you through our task trainer, and our residents leave knot ties all over the place and loose needles and other stuff. I'm scared to death of walking into the VIST, and there's three casters on three wires, and we have a limited amount of resources, and I'm not your mom, so I shouldn't have to pick up after you, but I do have to pick up and then have to piece it back together to be in a workable form, and in a perfect world, I'd like to have open hours where you can use it whenever you want, but like I said, you almost need to supervise so you don't.
Yeah. Chris, what comments? Because I know that's part of what you do, right?
Yep, we'll talk.
I think part...
They're not unique in what, they are experiencing. It's, it's getting in front of the right people, setting you guys up with the appropriate ways to, collect, maintain, your tools, your product, those types of things. So that's kind of one of the conversations.
I work with Tina, and they have similar problem in a sense that it's in the skills lab, it's in a corner, and when they got to using it, they purchased it and were doing it, and they got to use it, all the instruments that Chris had set up for them had disappeared.
Mm-hmm.
Done.
Yeah.
And then the actual body was turned around opposite, and we were wondering, I don't know how this is going to work. And that, but that was...
The endoscopy units, I come in and there's butts, throats, and everything else.
But like Carlos and Jones in Michigan Vascular at McLaren, they have their own room that nobody really can get into except maybe a resident like Bernardo or the fellows, right, which is really nice. Henry Ford is the same way. In their sim center, they have a closet where the simulator is, but it's locked, and nobody else can get in that. But the other issue is that no other specialties are using it, cardiology and radiology. And that, I know, is the problem because so I get... Bernardo taught, and he helps teach the other residents, and you guys are okay. Then all of a sudden, IR wants to join in, and they're terrible. Or maybe they're great, but then cardiology is bad. They're leaving the same thing. So it really is an education about the machine. It's an education about taking care of your equipment, which I think is part of an educational strategy, but it's different in a sense, is that you sort of have to... My thought is that you have to have educational champions in each specialty, and you have to meet in a simulation center and say, listen, this is a problem. We need to resolve this problem. This is hurting us financially, marketing-wise, and it's hurting the education of the residents. How do we go about doing this? And that includes access 24/7, which I totally believe in. You can't get into the Wayne Medical School task training room. They don't allow you to do it. And I lobby for it because Wayne State and the hospital are on two different places. So,
I would say those that are facing these challenges, let's have that conversation because I can directly impact the audiences that are using it.
So let's go through this and see if there's something here that might work for you, Audra, because that's it's important. So let's talk about the, anybody else have any other issues like that in their own thing? Because
same. It's in the Sim Center, but it's like back in a room, it's covered by stuff. We do have 24-hour access to it, but because there's not someone who's like expert trained on how to use it, we don't use it because we don't want to break it.
Right, and unfortunately, if you don't use it, you will break it, right? It's sort of that conundrum, right? And so it's a problem in the fact that I think the problem is that if you don't have a plan for its use, I mean, if you take the step back, and my thought is if I don't have a plan for using it, why'd I buy it? And so I think Nancy's comments yesterday were really right on the spot. If you're coming to me and you want to spend $100,000, $200,000 on a machine, what's your 1, 2, and 3-year plan for curriculum and all that? Because I think if you have a plan of action for how you want to implement the training, then I think that goes a long way to hopefully get to some of the issues that Audra's facing. The other problem, Audra, you may have to think about, this should probably be in the surgery offices. But
our...
Right.
So it has to be in the SIM Center.
Okay.
There's just no way, I can tell you, just from the size of that whole system, there's not going to be access after hours.
All right, so I mean, that's an institutional issue, and that's every institution, like all politics are local, right? You have to sort of fix that. I'm not sure, I mean, Chris there and Kathy, and if I was ever to come and I would look at it, I'd make a suggestion after looking how to do that, but I would find a way to get Bernardo and the residents' ability to get in there to use the machine when they felt they needed training independently or with you as a staff. Now, obviously, if you're to busy Sim Center and there are programs, you're going to have to pick and choose. And my option would be Saturday. And that's not a very favorable position to a lot of people, but I will tell you, as you see, with the Wayne State Group, we did Saturdays 4 hours. I did it every Saturday for 3 years straight, because we needed to get the training in. Our fellows weren't getting trained well enough. And we did Wednesdays for 2 hours, and then I did 7 to 10 hours of integrated time that was voluntary and available. So we did a total of 17, I did a total of 17-hour opportunity that may not sit with people who are busy clinicians. I wasn't operating, so but you may have to commit and do something a little above and beyond if you want your program to work. I mean, that's the sacrifice. It may be that I'm sacrificing one Saturday. I tried to get the Ford people to do that. They sort of hesitated. I said, I would be happy to come in and teach your residents and fellows on the simulator in the beginning on a Saturday. I'll give up my Saturday because I like doing it. They sort of hemmed and hawed. Back in my mind said, okay. you're not committed because you can't get the time. They can't get the time in the Sim Center either. They get 2 hours on a Friday, which isn't enough. But for them, that's small steps. But I said, the other option, we can give them 4 hours on a Saturday.
But not to be negative.
No, get sorry.
The duty hours.
Right.
I mean, that's their only,
you're a program director, you know this.
They kill me with the duty hours.
Yeah.
We've stopped doing grand rounds on Saturday. We stopped everything.
Right. Which is why my conversation with Carl from Northwestern is that this 80-hour and the simulation has to stop. But the problem is trying to be creative, and that's why looking at this, maybe combinations of these options. I totally agree. That was the argument Ford gave me, the 80-hour work week. And I said, well, I can come 2 hours every other Saturday so that it doesn't violate, so that the person on call on Saturday can get the training because there's less going on. It has to try and mix and match. The system is not friendly. It's friendly from Monday at 6 a.m. to Friday at 6 p.m., and that's what it's friendly for. And that's not really what we're in here for. I mean, that's not what we signed up for. So I understand. How about the open gym approach? No structured training. You just throw the balls out there, shoot a few layups, free throws, and hopefully you're going to become like Michael Jordan, right? No milestones, variable practice does not work. Inconsistent attendance, little or no feedback. It's essentially a voluntary program. There's no oversight. Proctors aren't present. There's no performance standards typically, and I've seen this, and it's not ideal and it's not recommended, but some people do that. Here's the lab. It's open. I'm going to give you a one-time shot. Go to it. I don't think that's a good way. Here's an example of show why it's not a good way. We did this in 2010, high feedback interval training of our people with FLS. 27 residents in 1 year, low feedback, open gym approach. They got taught one time on FLS and they're on their own versus the next year. And we did high feedback where we taught them every week for 16 weeks. So their initial times, everybody started at the same time. This was a task completion time. No difference. At 4 weeks, the high feedback group had dropped by a half compared to the low feedback group. Within 1 month, they were better than the group at 16 at 4 months. And that continued on and on. I don't want to spend it. But the bottom line is that high feedback, regular interval training matters. And this was an FLS. It has nothing to do with vascular or endovascular, but it was an FLS. So that type of training works. The other time, the next step too is, or the second is block time approach, where you have sort of like a skills boot camp concept early in the year, or you block out times on a regular basis, weekly or monthly. It provides a stable learning environment. It removes the decision making from the resident. Oh, I have a case. No. Carlo's group does 3 hours on Monday. There's no questions. They're there. That's what the group, his group made. That's what he made. You're not coming to cases. We can operate without you. We don't need you. But you need to be here 3 hours on a Monday to get trained on things that were important to for your education. It removes that decision making. It allows for appropriate preparation by the trainee because, number one, they know on the weekend, say in Carlos' group, they should have been preparing for what was coming on because they knew what the schedule was. It allows for a structured learning environment, which trainees need. It's fixed scheduling for the faculty proctors. The faculty know that, listen, I have to be on the second Monday, I have to be in the lab. Don't schedule me anything. That's my commitment to the program, 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hours. And I think it's probably the best simulation training approach if you can get it done. All right, it allows you to get all your set your metrics. It enables appropriate preparation for the faculties. It removes the uncertainty of clinical practice. It allows for performance of cases of varying lengths. So the idea is that if I have 3 hours of block time, I might want to do an aneurysm simulation, which takes me an hour and a half, as opposed to a iliac angioplasty, which takes me less than 20 minutes, or a carotid, which is 25 minutes. There are no time constraints, and the training and teaching is on performance, not speed. I don't have to get to my next case. So when you're developing your approach to implementing, you have to decide, am I going to do block time where these are the advantages or other ways? And again, the training and the teaching is on the trainee when you have lots of time. It's not on the clinical responsibilities, and that's important. You don't need clock watchers as faculty. You don't need clock watchers as trainees. You have to avoid that. And this is an example of a block training time schedule where we start low, diagnostic, and we move all the way up to the more complex. And I just stopped it at carotid angioplasty, but it's probably going to be EVAR or TVAR. Okay? And you set this. The McLaren group with Carlo and Michigan Vascular did this. So did Ford, and we did this at Wayne. Simple to complex, and I don't know whatever Tina is going to do at the University of Michigan. Whoop. So this is the Michigan Vascular experience. There's Carlo and Joan and Mohammed Saran, and then myself over here. This is their room, very nice. There's a big open window overlooking the parking lot. It's beautiful, but it actually is really good. It's a big window. Trust me, I've been in the Ford one. I've been in the one at Wayne State. I've been in the Tina's, which is good, and. But it's a nice open space. There's lots of space for the room. And so one to two proctors and Joan as a program director, I help them. They do 3 hours on Monday. Faculty presents. They get videotaped with help of Mentice, a faculty demonstration. And then there's technical training and cognitive teaching. I believe in you doing a mock orals on the simulator. That's how I teach. The Henry Ford, this is their little closet. They have an older version missed. This is the two fellows, Praveen and Jeff Matthews. Louis Cabani and I do most of the teaching for them, 2 hours a week on a Friday. Again, same format, technical training and cognitive teaching. What's the third approach? Well, it is the independent study approach where, again, not all systems work this way, where you just say, let's say Audra said to Bernard, you have 50 modules you have to get done in 5 years. Here's the syllabus. I don't care when you get it done. It just has to be done, and the milestones have to be achieved, right? It's your independent study. It's learner-driven. The performance milestones will depend on the faculty interest. The trainee time is flexible. You might get them all. He might do all 50 the last 50 days of his residency before he gets a job, right? Or in the first 50, or he spreads it out. Faculty time is minimal but variable. Faculty are available primarily as mentors and not as proctors. No set timetable for completion. And the recommendation is that Bernardo would practice with the deliberate practice concept, that you would go do the task in limited time, reach a milestone, understand your errors, okay? I think if you have a very independent resident, this can be done. It's not ideal, but it's another way to give them the opportunity to get in the skim lab if you had 24/7 access, okay? Simulation rotation approach, and again, depends on your residency or your training program, right? So say Ron had a resident who wanted to go into academics and be an academic interventional radiologist, and he wanted to learn how to simulation. Maybe he would take a year off, and his whole year would be like sort of what Tina's doing right now at Michigan, is that your whole year is designed for educational curriculum development on an endovascular simulator, or maybe it's open, whatever. And these are the things that it's a standalone rotation, okay? Training is required to complete, in this case, just for a month, pre-selected curricula. You have to achieve all the proficiency. The faculty determines the curricula. Training time is fixed, predetermined. Faculty time requirement is variable. The faculty acts as both a mentor and a proctor. You still use the deliberate practice concept. But the issue is, and again, this is the month approach, I misspoke, not the year, that you have to pass certain modules in the month to get credit for the rotation. It's like doing a GI endoscopy. It's like doing cardiac. It's like using whole body imaging, you know, when you're a resident, right? So there's a simulation rotation that all you do for a month is a simulation, right? I misspoke. The independent study one is the one that you can do as a year as a research concept. Does that make sense? So that's another way to get them involved. And then this is the way that I prefer. This is my interest, where you actually make the modules as part of the clinical rotation of whatever you're doing. If you're on vascular, that you're supposed to complete your month, but you're also supposed to complete 4 to 6 modules. And the modules are taught and you have to do it. So the modules are completed as part of the rotation. They're incorporated into the daily operative schedule. You have to complete the modules. They're a secondary objective for the rotation. It's a less structured environment. Clinical interruption is frequent because you have to. The clinical training is number one. There are time constraints that are more apparent, and you get less productive training. But it's a way you can rotate simulation training into clinical training. So when I get done, maybe I've done 20 cases as a PGY3 in the clinical realm and 15 cases in the simulation realm. And if I have appropriate curriculum, it means I've done 35 really good cases in a one-month rotation, and that training value is very good. You have to limit the cases from 30 to 45 minutes or less. Again, you place a premium on speed, and simulation cases are treated like live cases. I might do a carotid with Audra if I'm Bernardo, and then I might take Tom Bauer and do an iliac angioplasty in the Sim Center, and then come back and do an aneurysm with Audra or Peter Golbisky, come back and do a carotid simulated case in the sim lab, so it's back and forth. It provides access for additional cases for trainees who have smaller case volumes. Now, Mayo is very busy. I will tell you, at Wayne State, there are problems at times with volume. So where do our residents get training? They need to get it in the lab. Increased faculty is involved, though. You have to get more faculty involved, and scheduling is problematic. All right, because unless you're really integrated in simulation training, if I'm a faculty member who knows nothing, I'm thinking, I don't have time to do that, when actually they do. They just need to be educated on it. And then the one that we did at Wayne State is that it's both block and rotation. I think this is the best of both approaches. You have more opportunities. You get greater volume of cases. You have premium on speed and efficiency. It does require faculty involvement unless you're going to do it all by yourself. And you have to have some flexibility in your scheduling, and it requires more administrative leadership from the resident. They have to take control of that, okay? This is what we did. This is sort of my typical posture when they're training, you know. At least it will be today. This is Kumar Rai, who's in actually West Virginia. He's from Nepal. I'm sure he's having a good time in West Virginia, coming from Nepal. We had 4 fellows, 1 faculty proctor, 2 block days, 3-5 integrated days. We did both I assessed every single case for 3 years on them because we were trying to build some data, and we did some cognitive teaching. And this is sort of the way we set it up. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, not Wednesday, but we're integrated elective time. Wednesday, Saturday were block training times. The other faculty allowed me to do that because I was the only one doing it, and they didn't have to bother, so that was sort of their give. I wasn't operating, so this is not real life in the sense that one person can't do it, but if you took me and divided me up into 5 to 6 to 7 pieces, you could get this done. You just have to divide and conquer with one person who's the apex educator. the very top, which would be all of you, right? You're on top, you're the apex educator, the master educator, and everybody else has different percentages of involvement. Not everybody should be 10%, not everybody should be 50% in terms of the educating. And this is what we came up with. We had it on the average, there were 17 days available, but we only used about 2 hours per week. You know, we were not efficient, even with me being available. So there was still struggle, even though I talk about this, even our program, which I thought was pretty good then, it still struggled. And that's, I'll have the same issues that Audrey was brought up and everybody else is bringing up. So we use really about 40% of the available time per month. Okay? So again, we get back, what should be the focus when you're training? Should it be see one, do one, teach one? That's the old adage, right? Started with Halstead. But I don't think that works anymore. Now the question is see one, sim one, do one. But I don't think that's right either. I think it should be see one, sim one, no, sim 10, and then do one. All right. So we're still on time? Okay, good. All right. So Audra brought up some good points about how, what was the issue yesterday about the, oh, how do I keep my trainees interested?
Yeah.
Right? How do I not, I sat up last night thinking about ways to penalize them, you know, in my own sort of, you know. Listen, nobody's perfect, right? Devious ways. So, but there are roadblocks that we all face, and Dr. Duncan just brought one up. What do I, when I don't have 24-hour access, when I don't have people or trained residents are trained to use it, or when I have multiple users, or I don't have space, and we have two, we're too structured, all those things. And so the idea is that how do I overcome these roadblocks, and what are the strategies for the trainee, for the faculty, for the institution, and for yourself? Okay? I think because you are a big part of that. So, education 101 and simulation and teaching, right? You have to explain the educational value. You have to explain the clinical need and requirement. You have to explain the professional obligation that you all have as academic physicians. You have to explain the difference between clinical and simulation. Explain the time commitment. Explain the financial commitments. Remove the mystery, which for me is a big deal, big deal. And you have to have them embrace the unfamiliar to become familiar, okay? Because people always tell me I don't have enough time until you break it down. Yes, you do. You have 2 hours out of a 320-hour work week to do, or work month to do this, all right? So part of it is getting other people to understand what's the goal. The goal is, the skill goal is to change them from novices to experts, from conscious to automatic, to develop automaticity. That's the overreaching goal, to make them better surgeons. This is a very formal educational theory of saying we want you to be the best surgeon you possibly can, and this is how we think we should do it in 2014, because 20% of your case volume and clinical experience is gone. It's not coming back, because the people in administratively in the American College of Surgeons, and I like to liken it as this way, is that there's like prohibition. Prohibition was a great idea in 2015, but it wasn't in 2018 when the mafia came, right? But for 10 years, people said denied it. They put their head in the sand or up somewhere where the sun doesn't shine, and they ignored what was going on. And that's what's happening to our leadership in surgery. The 8-hour work week is a disaster. Doesn't work. 25% of all graduates are going on to extra training because they can't get enough. Funny how the 80-hour work week and 25% add up to 100 hours, which is what we were all doing before, and it was just fine. Just fine. But you got people who are politically interested in their political careers and not the training. Again, that's my FYI. I'll stop. But I don't like it. I think it's dumb. It makes no sense. But we want to make them experts. We can't make them experts in the OR as much as we can before, so we have to do it somewhere else. We create skill experts technically and cognitively. It's not just technique, it's thinking about it. Our job, we have to help them understand better what we're trying to do in simulation, which means we have to produce better training opportunities, and we want to create a better trainee. We want to create somebody who's better than last year's resident. We want to create somebody who's better than me. Do you think DeBakey was training residents to be better than he was? Are you out of your mind? Do you think Emmett Schlage was thinking anyone was going to be better than him? Carlo, Dr. DeLomo is a product of Emmett Schlage from Henry Ford. No. And that's why their teaching styles don't work, right? We want to make people better than me. I want the residents to have a better opportunity to be a better clinician, better technical surgeon than I am. And we can do that. But that's the principle you have to get across to the other people of the faculty, not just, oh, I'm in the lab, I got an hour, I got to do a femtiv, you know, all that. We're trying to make better residents. Bernardo, my guess is that Audra wants Bernardo to be better than she at some point in his career, or at least give him the opportunity to be better. John wants to give Tina the chance to do the same thing. Ron with his residents, and John, whoever your faculty and physiology, you know, who your people are. They want you to be better than me. Otherwise, we make no progress from a medical point of view. So the idea is that we want to highlight to the non-believers, to the people who are reticent, that some concepts, that a simulation skills module for every level of learner, every rotation, every specialty, whether that's IR, IC, vascular, general surgery, allied health personnel, basic intermediate skills are learned in the lab, and advanced skills wisdom is in the OR. You have to get that across. There's a disconnect with faculty who don't teach in the lab. They don't understand that. They think that the lab should be exactly like the OR. Well, it's not. There are differences. There are subtle differences. You can make it close, but there are differences, and so they have to come in with that knowledge base. And it's your job to help that, all right? Learners have different training experiences. These are some of the challenges that you have to present to your faculty. See, all this is, I'm telling you, as if you are faculty who don't believe in simulation, right? That I'm teaching to the choir, but this is what I would tell you. These are all the things that I should be telling you in a meeting with my department, why this is important for the four residents here to get this kind of training. All right? Well, we have, you know, there's increased financial stressors. You guys just want to get done. They're not doing cases from start to finish. You're only giving them, they're doing partial task training on real patients, and that's not okay. They don't get to start, do cases from start to finish. There's diminished time for teaching. We're not teaching the same quality. The public is on our butt because they want to improve outcomes, which means I can't let you operate, guys, because Mrs. Jones' son is a lawyer and he wants good results. You're going to have to watch this one out. You know, how many times has that played out? The work hour restrictions we talked about, and there are really no objective methods to test in the OR, though the APDVS is working on developing some metrics. What I've given you, you can use in the OR. The global rating scale can be changed to a clinical performance assessment instrument just like that. You add two things, and it's the same quality scale that you would evaluate somebody in the OR. And then the model that was designed by Halstead in the early 1900s may no longer apply because we really risk of training people by calendar date rather than competence. I mean, that's a problem that we're all having, and that's what I would tell other faculty member. The other thing I would say is that the learning has to move out of the OR and into the lab. We need to let trainees make errors in a risk-free environment, not stress-free. You don't see stress-free anywhere here, right? The lab is not stress-free because stress increases educational retention. Trainees get consequence-free, so you tell your institution, you tell your surgeons, and it's liability-free learning. There's no risk, and that's one of the arguments you make to the institution. Liability-free learning, no risk of patient harm. Reduces errors, provides objective methodology. It's not a replacement, though, but residents have to come with a clinical performance edge, and you tell them straight up. So you tell your faculty and say, listen, you're not there to be a passive educator. If they're not performing, you give them the business. And you say, this is not appropriate. This is not appropriate for you to come to the lab and waste my time. My time is $1,000 an hour. That's what I would get if I'm operating. If you're wasting my time, we're going to have a discussion with the program chair, the PD, and the rest of the group, as a group, all the trainees, because this doesn't work in 2014. This is not your grandmother's surgical skills lab, as I like to tell Dr. Dunnington and Dr. Foles. Right, this isn't the touchy-feely, the University of Toronto, McGill Skills Lab. it's high stakes stuff now, right? And the focus is on you as the learner, not the patient. So you're educating everybody of why we need to be in the lab, all right? And again, not your program chairman simulation training in the 90s. Performances are being profiled. You're being profiled. There's no way around it. Training is high stakes, whether or not it's in the OR or out of the OR. And the learner needs to understand the following, and you make this to them, is that if you come unprepared, if you act indifferently, if you perform poorly consistently, everybody makes errors, but if you make the same mistakes despite the instruction, and if you don't show up, you're going to fail. You put that out there right away. You're going to fail, and we're going to dismiss you. I don't care. There are people who will take your job tomorrow, is what we tell them. Tomorrow. I have residents who are really good residents who can't get a job. They're prelims, they can't get a job. And so they're going to do something else that they hate. So they have to be prepared. Okay? Well, how do I get my faculty? You educate the learners. You tell the learner that the simulation lab has equal value as the clinic and the non-invasive lab, if you're a surgeon. Could you have a non-invasive lab rotation, Ron, with you guys?
No.
It's just part of what you guys do?
Well, they do it during diagnostic.
Okay.
During the 4 years before they do it.
Okay. So the idea is that there's equal value to the lab in everything else, not maybe equal to clinical work to in the OR or the IR suite or the cardiac cath lab, but every other part. To get to Audra's point about how do I get to the senior residents who feel like this is a loss of OR time, you may not be able to do that. They may not feel that that's the way. But I would start my program on day one of training, tell the juniors that this is the way it is. You signed up for it. There's plenty of people who would be happy to take your place, but you may lose some of the senior residents who were not involved in the beginning, who feel as PGY 4 and 5, oh, you're taking away my OR time. They're going to be the hard sell.
Doing, because they've got a clock ticking. So right. Even though they're going to have to teach probably most of them in the following year, that's not their interest.
Right.
You know, I think some of it is generational, just like the 80-hour work week. Mm-hmm. The junior residents who came in doing tons of simulation are going to learn that's what it is. And they're not going to fight it as much as the ones who are doing it now didn't start doing it as interns. I think some of that will just
go away. I have a pretty nice quote from, you know who Max Planck is? Does anybody know who Max Planck is? He's a theoretical physicist from the 1936, and it goes with this, and I didn't put it on, but he says, any new idea will become the state of the art. You just have to wait for everybody else to die. Essentially, because it's what Audra just said, is that you have to wait for these guys to graduate, and as they come into it, right? And the physicists are terrible, man. They hate each other. If it's not my theory, there's no theory, right? So the bottom line is that some senior residents may consider it a loss, and you do your best, but you realize that may be a lost cause. And as soon as they're gone, you know that the next level of residents, this is part of the program. It's part of the thing. You can't get away from it. Other thing I would recommend when you talk to residents and you try and educate residents and faculty, you avoid random insertions into your program. Don't just show up, hey, we're doing simulation today, and disrupt the whole thing. They will dislike you for a while and dislike what you're trying to do. So avoid scheduling surprises. Keep it consistent, be prepared, be fair, and be thorough, all right? Make sure that they can count on a day to train. And then when all else fails, get the chairman and the program director to support it and say, sorry, he said they have to do it, you know? So the bottom line is, though, it's necessary, right? I mean, I say that halfway approved, but this goes a long way. Most simulation programs, with just a stroke of a pen, the chairman says, we're doing this, it's done. There's no argument. Otherwise, you'll be out of a job, you know? But not a lot of chairmen want to be that heavy-handed. There are some that will. So, but the learner has a responsibility, too, and you have to point this out to them. They have to come prepared, and they have to come with a clinical performance edge. And what I mean by that is that I don't believe that the lab should be stress-free. I think it needs to be full of stress. Stress while you're having fun, but it needs to be full of stress. And I think if you don't come with the clinical edge to perform, you're not going to learn anything. I think I'm consistent with a lot of people that if I just come with this half-baked attitude, I'm not going to learn anything. But if I know, if I'm on the edge, that I need to perform, that I'm actually being profiled, that I'm actually being evaluated, I'm going to be prepared. Maybe it's a competitor in me, maybe not. I think all of us are competitive, which is why we're here. You have to come prepared with a clinical edge because you want to make it as close to clinical work as possible. When you're not being assessed, you have to tell the learner they have to practice with purpose. You can't come to the lab by yourself as a learner. I'll use Bernardo, right? And Bernardo said, oh, I'm just going to come put some catheters and wires in the carotid and shoot some angios and we'll go, right? No. Bernardo should say, I want to do a carotid angiogram in less than 10 minutes and use less than 50 cc's of contrast. Can I do that? And then I'm going to look at the internal metric errors on the VIST and see whether or not I've actually achieved this without making any errors. And then I'm going to look at my external physician developed errors and see whether or not I've created some errors. So I've taken responsibility and purpose for my practicing, right? So now you come in and you practice with purpose. This is for the independent, right? You have to do that. You have to tell the learner they have to do that. Make sure that they have open-mindedness to criticism, all right? Tell them that you can make mistakes. Don't be shy in the lab. This is your chance. In the OR, you can't do that, but don't make mistakes. Accept simulation training as a way to assess your evaluation and performance. Don't have them look at it as something different, but still differentiate. It's not clinical work. It's not the same, but it's getting close, okay? Those are the responsibilities that the learner has, okay? How about faculty reluctance, which, you know, how many of you said, can you guys help me? Oh, no, I don't have time today, you know. So you got to make the simulation training part of the fabric of the educational program. How you do that could be through the chairman, through the program director, just through your relationship with others. Appeal to their academic ego. You're in academics. I tell this to Carlo all the time, right? In a sense, to his group, is that they got a fellowship, a brand new fellowship, great fellowship. But now you have a responsibility to train three fellows a year. And it's, you know, from a private practice, successful private practice group with general surgery resident training to a fellowship, changes the whole dynamic a little bit in terms of what your responsibility is here. So you paid for that. You're gonna have to do it. So appeal to the academic ego that you're doing the right thing. Make sure your faculty are educated on current educational thinking and theory. Show the value of the simulation training. Use current internal data. See they improved on this device. What are they doing in the OR, and then use evidence-based external data that shows practical effectiveness of simulation training. You may have to make a sacrifice if you're the primary person who's running the simulation in your program. And what does that mean? It means you may have to switch schedules. It means you might have to take an extra OR case day to have them do simulation. It means you might have to take an extra day of call. If you want it to work, you have to make that. It's no different than a business, right? You hear all the stories about I started my own business and we didn't get a paycheck for 2 years while we worked. No different here. You're not getting a paycheck here. You're working extra to make sure your simulation program works. You can't expect them to input the same amount of energy that you're putting in because you're the apex educator. So everything else falls down from you. And you may have to give vacation credits, EVUs, educate, you know, whatever it is. They may have to have some work compensation options for the faculty who don't normally train. The bottom line is you have to get them involved, capture them, and then change the way they look. And oh, by the way, the chairman says you have to do it. You know, that's the bottom line. And the GME and the ACGME. How do I educate them further? Educate that the faculty, you're only going to use 45 minutes a day. Or 45 minutes a week, one time a week. That's all I want you to train. Reemphasize what the value is educationally. Detail the aspects. Take the mystery out of it. Tell them that it can be done in between cases at lunch. There's no paperwork, that the fellow or the resident gets everything ready for you. Make sure that they know how to use the simulator. There's nothing worse than a faculty member who shows up and says, now what do? I don't even know how to turn it on. And then automatically they're done. So your job is to teach them that. Point out the differences between the clinical and simulator-based teaching. Emphasize minimal preparation and requirement. Make may require your presence at all the cases, just the way it is. Help them prepare. So there's extra work involved. I mean, Ron just gave a great talk about all the work he did for people who didn't have as much interest. Make it easy, remove all the obstacles, and you have to get the trainees to make sure there are no delays, because the kiss of death is if I'm a faculty member who is on this line and I show up and I can't get the machine started and there's no wires and they're late, I'm never coming back. You've lost them, right? So faculty responsibility is the same as the resident. Be prepared, have an edge, proctor with purpose, teach with open-mindedness, be willing to let the worker, the learner work at their own speed. Don't push them to your speed because they're not there. Except that you can use simulation training as an evaluation. Understand how to teach differently in simulation versus clinical. And understand the difference between competence and performance, right? The biggest argument I get, and this is called from the Cambridge model, the argument I get is that, boy, this is not like real life. Well, it's not like real life, because in the lab, we teach competence at skills. In the OR, in the IR, in the endo suite, we teach performance. And performance is based on system-related and individual-related influences. There are two competing ways to evaluate people. Competence in the lab, not competence in the OR, performance in the OR, performance clinically. There's two different things, and you have to get that difference across to not only the faculty member, but also to the trainee and the learner. And that separates out the two. It makes it easier, because you can't go into a skills lab and think, boy, I'm just going to be like the OR. And then you realize, well, it's not the OR. It's a black box. It's two monitors. There's no influences, right? It's different. So how do I overcome the institutional reluctance? And again, Dr. DeLomo has had a great experience at McLaren about talking to administration about getting things done. He'd be a great resource. Emphasize patient safety, uniformity of training and skill acquisition, academic prestige are all worthy goals. Be able to separate yourself from other healthcare providers in the region. That's the politically correct way. The impolitically correct way is we want to bury the competition. Make no bones about it. It's a competitor. I want to bury the competition. We want to separate me from them. Develop new partnerships with industry, possible revenue sources. You get a downward effect on some malpractice insurance costs. And you have your return on simulation investment, or called ROSI, right? This is how you tell the administrators. There are soft and hard dollars. There are direct and indirect costs, time savings, error reduction, faster time to competence, decreased equipment repair and costs, reduction in alternative training costs, revenue from selling space on the simulator, outside programs coming to your place, paying you money to train, industry and others, okay? All right, this is really important for all of you. How do you overcome your own individual roadblocks? Are we doing okay for time?
You have 13 minutes.
Okay, I think we're okay. Apex simulation educator, you have to believe that you're the man or you're the woman. I'm it. I believe in yourself. You got to believe in your program. You cannot let anything get in the way. You want to make it work, nothing gets in the way. You have to defend it with evidence-based data, internal, external, and always be consistent with your approach. Never vary. If you have to, get multi-level user groups. Build up support. Small victories count, right? For me, when I did it in the beginning, it was the medical student, you know, and the PGY1 and the vascular. So I took the medical student. I mean, they love it because you're paying attention to them. You're a full-time faculty member. You're not a resident. I mean, they love that kind of stuff. So little steps. Start small, think big. One 100% success is better than three 33% successes. So don't overstep your bounds. Don't try to eat all the elephant at once, and have a plan. 1, 2, 3-year plan of what you're going to do. Nothing worse when you're all excited and they say, well, what's your plan for next year? And, oh, I don't have one yet. And then that's when they sort of show you the door, say, come back, you know. These are things that you have to overcome yourself, all right? Okay. How should we measure performance? In as many ways as possible. Okay. What do we, what, do we...
I think we can break here.
Okay.
Break was scheduled at 10, but we can break here if you want.
Yeah, so what do we, remind me what's after next?
So after the break,
yeah,
we have understanding your options for using performance assessment instruments.
Yeah, that's in, yep, we're okay. Okay, so we're on time. We can take a break now and then just... Is everybody all right with that? Number one, questions.
Yeah,
I'm sorry. I've been talking and everybody's been sort of sitting there and this gets real boring and you're going to get bored and listen to me. I'm sorry. So we're going to stop there. Questions about, I think Audra brought some great points up. Anybody else having issues? Yeah.
I have a question about, so if you don't have faculty support on this, is the only way that you think is the best way, the independent study approach, and would that work for like an early, like junior resident?
So are you saying that you're the only one who's probably doing the work where you're at? I mean, that you can be honest.
Well,
what goes on in simulation lab stays in simulation lab. That's another quaint saying that we have.
I would say that I'm a very junior resident.
Yeah.
Who we have the simulator.
Uh-huh.
There's two IR faculty where I'm at.
Okay.
One didn't even know it existed, and the other is very busy.
Sure.
We have to justify the purchase very soon.
Excuse me, are you a resident? You're a resident? Mm-hmm. IR resident?
No, radiologist.
Great. Okay. Yeah, okay.
So we have to get this going, but we don't have an IR fellowship.
Okay.
So we don't have, or a vascular fellowship. So we don't have fellows that are going to use this.
Right. So it's, and you have a machine now, or you're going to get
one?
We
have a machine.
Nice. So I think the way to do it is that, number one, if you had a curriculum, then you could independently do the studying and go to a radiology faculty and say, listen, I don't need you to proctor me because I know you don't have time. But again, what's the setup? The setup is that I want you to be my mentor primarily, but my proctor secondarily. I'll do and you have the plan. The plan is I want to do an independent study and work on the simulator. I need Chris's help to get me there, or it's Mentice's support to get me there and include their faculty member. And then you're probably going to have to do independent because you don't have a defined block integrated time where you can do that because you have faculty members that have other competing interests. So yes, you're perfectly correct. The independent study modality would probably be best for you. But I would also integrate faculty maybe on a once a month basis and say, listen, I need you 2 hours a month. To sort of, I'm going to show you what I've done, tell me what I'm doing right or wrong technically.
But that's for so this has to be not just for myself, but for all of our radiology residents.
Mm-hmm.
So that you just develop that curriculum
and have it be used
with the residents.
Yep,
along the way.
Absolutely. And I would start small in a sense. I would not try and do everything in a year, mm-hmm. right? And maybe I pick one topic per month. So that you have a whole month to say you're going to do diagnostic angiography of the lower extremity, which is an aortogram AIF with runoff, and get all that technique and do repetitions. Now, what I found is that we had to do at least 16 reps for them to get to a level of expertise, which was less than 10 minutes, less than 50 cc's of contrast with no errors. You'll decide what that is, and then you can have your faculty proctor sort of oversee that, right? But again, you're going to have to take some of that independent training because you don't have faculty or institutional support, which is why we had those five different options. So it's a great question. But that's what I would do. And I would go to your faculty just to ask them a question, say, what do you think are the 12 most important things that I need to know as a radiology resident from an endovascular interventional radiology point of view? And they'll give you an opinion, and then you... Again, right, the solution is I'm going to be expert at 12 things, but I retrograde or I reverse engineer how I'm going to develop everything. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Mark, you mentioned two basic approaches. So it's a simulation rotation and integrated into clinical rotation.
Yeah.
So both are valid. We have both. But North Shore, mm-hmm. University of Chicago General Surgery residents rotate. They spend 2 weeks at PGY 2 level, and we have 10 modules for them. It's basic. Endoscopy, FLS, open stapling, laparoscopic stapling, 10 modules. Then when they go to specialty rotations, they come back one day a week for 2 or 3 hours. So say they rotate on colorectal, we do anterior or anterior resection. If they do HPV, we do laparoscopic ultrasound, and so on. So We have only two modules, you know, it's a venous closure in case of trauma and embolectomy. We thought about introducing, not exclusively, but this would be one of the modules for vascular rotation at PGY2 level.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of skill rotation, those guys have minimal exposure to endovascular intervention. So we bring them every, let's say, every Wednesday for 3 hours. Would that be enough work here?
Yeah. Yeah. Because the whole idea is that you have to decide, are you wanting to just introduce them to the module, or do you want to make them a skill expert? I mean, what we found is that, like for renals, you have to do a minimum of 30 renals on the simulator to become what we believe to be an expert. Carotage, you need 35. We found that the learning curves, and I didn't want to get into showing that, but the learning curves never flattened out until those numbers. There was too much variability. And there was no independent study, so I was there at every single case, watching them, evaluating them, and so I think you can. I think you just have to decide what your primary goal is for that three-hour period, and then just go from there. Sometimes it's just a repetition goal, not a proficiency-based goal, and I didn't get into that. Sometimes you just say, I just want to get them 10 reps. And you know that in those 10 reps, they will improve their skill set, where that's the goal and not the actual performance. All right? Does that make sense? Yeah. I think I talked with Nancy yesterday. Yeah, you guys are already doing the things with the integration rotation, which I think is great. So, anybody else? Bernardo, you have any questions? Or Susan, or anything?
How do you correlate this clinically after one goes through like 30 or 35 repetitions? What do you see in the when the trainee actually goes and do it in the real life outside of the simulation?
I personally believe that it's going to be very difficult to do that for the following reason. If I teach you how to do an IVC filter with the option filter from Argon Medical, and we do 30 reps and over a three-month period of training, that's just the, all right, you may not see a filter for 7 months. So what's happened between end of training, 7 months later, where you've had experience maybe the influence from doing arterial work has influenced your venous catheter work. And an IVC filter shouldn't be that difficult, right? How do I connect the two? You can't. That's why simulation training, the curriculum is so important. It has to stand on its own 2 feet. And that's Agarwal from London talked about practical effectiveness in simulation training, which shows improvement from start to finish. And that's why there's a big push to develop all these appropriate validated tools. Like my stuff is not validated at Wayne State. And why is that? Because I'm the only person who did it. I never got another observer to help me. And so it's value nationally. I can talk to the cows come home, but from a validated point of view, you need multiple evaluators. And that's where I fell down in terms of our program, but I couldn't get anybody to help. But the secondary goal was to get them practically effective training that showed improvement, even if it was my personal bias. You know, you go with what you have. So it's going to be hard to do that. You may say, Audra, do you guys do carotid stenting at Mail with the residents, or is that done with neuro?
No, we do.
Okay.
Not a lot. Nobody does a lot.
Right. So how do I determine whether or not carotid stenting on a simulator helps me with three carotid stents per year, you know what I mean? Or maybe you do 5 in your 5-year training program. How do I make that connection? Well, you don't, unless your simulation training curriculum and your syllabus and your teaching is robust and you could actually show improvement, and you can show improvement with 2 observers. I just think we're in a point where we're not seeing as much volume all the time, and so we don't have that immediate step up into clinical work. Like I do an iliac today, I'm going to do one tomorrow in the OR. No, that doesn't happen. So you have to, that's why we're doing the workshop. We want you guys to build curricula that's good enough to train. Same thing with Susan, you do a lot of neural stuff, right? And facile, I mean, how many embolizations do you do in the brain for aneurysms? You maybe not do one a week, but on the other hand, if it's spread out, how do I know that your simulation training is good enough in the simulation lab to allow you to do it? you just have to take it on faith that you're using smaller catheters and everything else. There is a bit of taking it a little bit on faith, but also if you have good curriculum and good assessment metrics, you can still make that connection. So, but I'm all about simulation training standing on its own 2 feet as a training tool that doesn't have to be connected to clinical work, which is the argument. All this has no clinical connection until you raise the discussion that I just had with you guys. And then the faculty say, oh, yeah, that makes some sense. All right, so let's take a break, I guess. Yep, I need to.
15 minutes.
15, good. All right. Thanks for keeping me on time.